I did happen to catch a little bit of the Super Bowl in my delirium, and I did notice one of the ads. Of course, every year the Super Bowl ads are the big deal, right?
Yeah.
And I caught one that just, it was a Chrysler ad, Jim. I think you saw it already.
Yeah, the like worst loser car company in America now.
And I think this is going to, you know, lead us into a pretty interesting topic about what's going on in America. But let's just watch that ad, and okay. Listeners, you can hear, you know, you can hear what's going on in the ad. So I'm going to play it right now.
I got a question for you. What does this city know about luxury? Huh? What does a town that's been to hell and back know about the finer things in life? Well, I'll tell you. More than most. You see, it's the hottest fires that make the hardest steel.
We're seeing scenes from Detroit.
Add hard work and conviction.
Allegedly.
And the know-how that runs generations deep in every last one of us.
They're just showing little fragments of stuff.
That's who we are. That's our story. Now, it's probably not the one you've been reading in papers. The one being written by folks who've never even been here and don't know what we're capable of. Because when it comes to luxury, it's as much about where it's from as who it's.
They're not showing the plywood over the windows in Cadillac Square.
We're from America, but this isn't New York City, or the Windy City, or Sin City, and we're certainly no one's Emerald City.
Here comes Eminem and his Chrysler. Do you think he regularly drives a Chrysler? Do you think that's his main car?
I don't think so.
I kind of doubt it. So he's going into the Fox Theater, which has been famously renovated. It's a huge 1920s performance space.
This is the Motor City. This is what we do.
Yeah, he's like a sullen wretch. You know, he represents everything that's insecure about America.
Okay,
what
so
a strange advertisement.
Yeah, it's weird. And listeners, if you didn't actually see the ad, I'm going to put a link to it. You can watch it online.
I think it's largely really dishonest. I do think that a lot of the images that they flashed were, you know, arguably not even from Detroit. It was just sort of a pistache of imagery and a claim, an assertion that Detroit's okay now.
Yeah, so let's just start with the very...
Based on nothing.
What is the premise? They're talking about Detroit knows luxury and they're building some new luxury car. I don't even get the point of
Well,
the
I think the point was that, you know, Americans think that American cars are crap. And they're trying to assert that, oh, no, Detroit may have been down and out, but now it's come back and we build wonderful cars. And but it's just an assertion, you know, it's just an empty assertion. I have no idea whether Chrysler cars are that wonderful, but I have a suspicion that, you know, maybe the German ones are a little bit better.
I rented a car with a friend a couple months ago, yeah. And it was a Chrysler. And he commented on how he felt like we were driving a giant piece of Tupperware. I mean, it's just like the inside of it, everything was so puffy and plastic. And it was like an ogre was wearing gloves had assembled the thing.
Yeah. You know? I've had really bad experiences in American rental cars with just incredibly, amazingly bad engineering. A particular Chevy convertible comes to mind that I rented in Maui about 5 or 6 years ago. And, you know, the thing was so badly designed. The windshield, once the top was down, you know, the windshield came to this, like, razor-sharp point at the corner. And the way it was designed, you almost took your eye out every time you swung around to get into the driver's seat. If you put a map up on the dashboard was so deep, you know, because the windshield was so raked.
I know, I've seen that before.
Like you couldn't get the shit that you put on the dashboard.
Yeah,
you know,
it's
like
gone.
If you put your tickets up there or something, you know, they'd be swallowed up forever. You couldn't get your knuckles to fit in the space.
I know. You wonder...
You need forceps to get them out.
Do American car manufacturers, do they sit in the car before they start selling them? Or before they start mass manufacturing, do they sit in the prototype? Because you could see these
things. I have no idea how they could arrive at such a bad outcome. I mean, given the number of engineers and, you know, even artists who are employed in their design departments, it's just, it's one of those abiding mysteries, like why the birdies sing.
Right.
But this actually gets us on to a somewhat broader topic of America's apparent, unbelievably huge inferiority complex at the moment. And it's being masked, or we're compensating for it with all of this incredible triumphalism and bravado and claims of our wonderfulness and exceptionalness. And, you know, we never hear the end of this talk. It's everywhere. It's in the Super Bowl. It's in the State of the Union address. It's in all our advertising. It seems to occupy about 97% of the political arena. And all it shows me is really how insecure and fucked up we are.
Yeah. So going back to that Detroit commercial and then moving ahead forward, you see that commercial as just kind of this weird pep rally, and you think that even the imagery that they're showing of the city of Detroit is they're pretending that that's what Detroit looks like.
I'm quite sure that some of the images that were in there were not even of Detroit. They were just, you know, just slammed together by an advertising agency. Like they showed a doorman in front of what was, seemed to me, pretty obviously a stretch of sidewalk on Fifth Avenue in New York.
Or even if there's something that looks like that in Detroit, that's not the norm, right?
Even
if
I can't even believe that there is anything that looks like that. I've been in Detroit a lot.
Right.
And, you know, there's certainly nothing in the center of the city, in the really old, dense urban part like that.
Yeah.
I very much doubt that there's anything like that in Grosse Pointe or, you know, Bloomfield Hills or any of the wealthier suburbs. I think it was just a complete fake. But anyway, more interesting to me than that was the body language of Eminem.
Yeah.
You know, and Eminem is a successful young man and has been for actually about 10 years now.
And he's from Detroit, apparently.
He's from, yeah. I mean, that whole bio movie about him was called 8 Mile, and that's because the design of Detroit is based on these roads, that these big collector highways that you know, are disposed a mile out from each other.
Yeah.
So you come to, like, you know, there's like 6 Mile Road, 8 Mile Road, 9 Mile Road, 12 Mile Road, blah, blah, blah. And the city is pretty gnarly, pretty far out along this ring of roads. I mean, 8 Mile, which is, you know, apparently 8 miles from some center point in the city, is a slummy neighborhood. So, and that's Eminem's hood. So, but what interested me about him is, you know, here you have this guy who's now in his 30s. You know, he's a father at least once, maybe more than that. I don't know. He's had his share of adult experience and melodrama. But, you know, he hasn't been starving for a long time. But the disposition of his body and his facial expressions, everything about him makes him look like a sullen wretch.
Yeah.
You know, like a peevish little boy. And, you know, I'm sure it's part of his persona, his stage persona, his showbiz persona. But it tells us a lot about how we feel about ourselves. You know, that a grown man... you know, a truly grown man, not a kid anymore, you know, presents himself as a sullen wretch of a sort of adolescent. And that's where we're at. But, you know, the Super Bowl itself is an exercise in the most grotesque triumphalism. You know, of the most amusing thing about it, of course, is the idea that, you know, we seem to be surprised that there's going to be a winner. You know, like it's a contest between two teams and that somebody's going to win, you know?
Well, why are we surprised there's going to be a winner?
Well, I mean, we act as though if there's any question that somebody will win it, you know? Because what it does is it guarantees that we'll be able to feel good about ourselves because there'll be a winner. And they engineer the whole thing so that it takes place in some usually Sunbelt city, very far from the actual contestants,
right.
So that whoever wins, you'll be able to feel good about yourself. You won't be in the city that's the losing city.